This is a Spooky Scotty production.
The views expressed and opinions given by the individual hosts and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of Z-Talk Radio, its affiliates, or sponsors.
Well, hello, everybody. You are listening to The Buzz on ztalkradio.com. And boy, you talk about just making it in time. We have literally just walked in the doors. Molly had some guests today. And
I did. I've had them since Friday.
And I literally just pretty much, well, probably about 15, 20 minutes ago, just walked in the door from work.
So, wow. So you're coming in by the skin of your teeth too, huh?
Man, yeah. But, you know, it's a good thing, though. Look how good we are, Molly. The show is up and running and on time. So welcome. Welcome, everybody,
welcome
to The Buzz.
Yeah.
Now we can all sit down together and just sit back and chill and relax and hopefully be entertained.
Yeah. I have had company all weekend again and had just an awesome time. I've had the Mountain Gypsies here who are Cat Young, Tess Hughes, and they brought along Nick White. And he is on a show tonight. You need to set your recorders right now for your TV show. It's on A&E, and it just starts at 9 o'clock, and it's a series. It's called Cursed, the Bell Witch, and it's I think he said there's 5 episodes of that.
Yes.
So if you ever have wondered about the Bell Witch, this is where you'll find out all the information.
You know, and we have a lot of people, Molly, ask us about the Bell Witch.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not even sure about the history myself.
So I am recording it right now as we speak. We made sure that it was up and running by the time he left. And so it should be interesting. He won't be in this episode, but he will be in next week's episode. But it was funny because he went, you know, I live in Athens, and he went into Athens and got a pizza the other day, and when he walked in, the owner of the store, the pizza shop, recognized him.
Oh, that's cool, isn't it?
Isn't that cool?
Yes.
And he said, "Who would have thought?" You know, and I thought, well, that's pretty cool.
Well, you know, you never know who you are until other people tell you, you know?
Exactly. Exactly. So that was really neat. So he, of course, he's proud of the show and you know, was telling everybody as we went along, you know, who he was and about the show and make sure that they record it and everything. So,
well, we have a new show coming to Z-Talk Radio, Molly. I think sent you a little bit of information about that.
Well, if you did any time in the last few days, I probably not have seen it. We have been busy. They got here Friday afternoon, and then Saturday we did healings all day, and Sunday we did a mountain magic class that took all day, and we just kind of been working on each other today, so I have not been on the internet at all.
Oh, well,
but
we.
You'll have to tell me about the new show, or tell everybody about the new show.
Yeah, well, I'm a little excited about it. You know, maybe a little controversial, but we're going to introduce our first political show on ztalkradio.com. Yeah, political show.
How's it going to work? Okay.
Well, we're going to try to balance it out. You know, we're going to have, you know, this show, and then I'm going to try to introduce another show as soon as I find one that's comparable. But we are going to start hosting the Rod Eccles show.
Okay.
And if you had to compare him with anybody, he likes to call himself, now not my words, but these are his own words, he has been compared to, he says he is the Black Rush Limbaugh.
Oh. Okay.
And I've listened to several episodes so far. I think I've listened to probably about 10, 11 episodes. And I am very much a fan.
Oh, good.
So okay. I'm a little excited about it. Now I've got to find somebody that's a little left-leaning. So if anybody knows of any good shows out there that would be high enough quality to come onto Z-Talk Radio, I'd be more than happy to entertain it.
And what night is this on and time?
Well, we're still working out all the details. We're actually going to try to make it a daily show because it's a nationally syndicated show and it broadcasts daily.
Oh, okay.
So I am looking, I'm hoping, me and Scotty are trying to work it out, to put it on every morning. When we don't have any live shows running, we've got plenty of open spaces in the morning hours, and I'd like to run it about 9 till 11 a.m.
Oh, okay.
So I'm just a little excited.
You sound like it.
I am. Oh, hey, V. V's on, and she's saying hello to everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah, like Molly said, just come skidding in.
We did.
The dust hasn't even settled in your driveway yet.
Not yet. Oh boy, I tell you what, we've had a good time though. They came in to speak for the Paranormal Study Center, you know, in Huntsville Friday night, and had an outstanding crowd. We had almost, I think we had 72 people.
Oh wow, that is great.
And then we had, I think, 10 or 11 people signed up for healings on Saturday. And then we had, I think, 11 in our Mountain Magic class Sunday. But they were so well received that they are coming back in 2 weeks. And we'll be doing the same thing again. The Mountain Magic classes, there's 4 segments of that. And so I've done the first one, and I'll do the second one next time they come. And those that missed the first one, they can take it, and then, you know, the ones that have taken the first one can do the second one while they're here. So it'll all work out, I guess.
Mountain.
But everybody has just been so busy, so busy, and. But we had a great time.
Good. And now you're talking about a magic class. What did they cover?
I can't go into that. You have to.
Okay. I apologize, because you got me picturing it in my head. I'm like, oh, that's cool.
It's not magic. It's God's magic.
Well, that's magic.
Magi, yeah, it is. But I'm talking magic. Hocus pocus magic stuff.
Oh, no, not pulling rabbits out of the hat or anything like that.
No. Yeah, so it is magic. And the next class will be, this one was more or less on getting to know yourself. So, and that's all I can tell you about it.
Okay. Not even a hint?
No, we have to sign a contract on this that we're not allowed to tell anybody.
Oh, wow.
On their teachings.
Well, that makes it all that much more exciting, doesn't it?
It does.
Well, enough said, because if you tell me, you'll have to, kill me.
But everyone, yeah, I would. But everyone that took it, I think, was very pleased, and it was just phenomenal. I thought it was anyway. And I had already bought my hat. I don't know what that means, Pat or Bob. I don't know. Somebody.
He may be responding to somebody
about.
Else. But
no.
Well, speaking of cool, let me tell you a little bit about our guest tonight.
Mm-hmm.
We are going to be joined by Lynn Russell. And she has procured a profession as a family counselor and has loved every moment of it. But as she's counseled people and have talked to people, she actually became fascinated with near-death experiences. And whenever she was asked to research it, she didn't hesitate. And what she has learned, she has actually been able to concise it into a book called The Wonder of You and What Near-Death Experiences Tell You About Yourself.
Cool.
Yeah, it's offers readers insight to their own spiritual journey. So your timing is perfect, Molly, when you're talking about learning about yourself, through this course. And mm-hmm. then Lynn Russell is going to kind of tell us a little bit tonight on what our near-death or our death experiences actually tell us about ourselves, maybe on the spiritual side.
Well, do you have to have a near-death experience to understand what she's talking about? Or is this just what she's found out through others that have had near-death experiences?
Yes, what she's okay. what she has learned. In her own research, she, discovered deeply hidden messages about the world, life, the paths we travel. And I'm kind of getting a hint the more I talk to her. We're all following a common theme here lately
mm-hmm.
about our connectedness with everything.
Exactly. Well, I'm anxious to hear what she's got to say, Well, I'll ask her.
Yes.
I'm asking you all the questions.
Oh, no. I am not the expert in near death. Now, I can talk to the dead, but that's too late for them, right?
Yeah, we want them to come back and tell us about it.
But she's Amazing. Researched over 2,500 cases.
Oh, my goodness.
I mean, how do you
And how long, to... how long has she been doing this?
She's been doing family practice for, I believe... My goodness, almost 30 years.
Wow.
But, everybody's, we're experiencing a quickening, a global awakening, because people are getting more and more and more interested in, not so much the paranormal, but if I can use a broader label, the metaphysical.
Mm-hmm.
What lays beyond this physical world, and I'm knocking. Ooh, I shouldn't do that. I'm knocking on the marble ball on my bed. this physical world.
I'm trying to do two things at once. I can't walk and chew gum at the same time here. So I'm not trying meaningly to
No.
giving dead air here, but I was trying to type something in the chat room, and it's like, I can't do two things at once. I can't multitask today.
No worries. I got plenty of energy tonight. I've had a really, really good day.
Well, good. What's been happening?
Well, that's just the thing. Nothing. When you work at a jail and nothing has happened, that's a good day.
Well, I guess.
Oh, man, because every time you hear the radio, you'll get somebody that gets on the radio and they sound excited, and boy, you want to talk about a bunch of sphincters slamming shut. Because you're like, oh, God, what's happening?
Wow.
We have this one individual who works in an undisclosed location inside the jail. He may be listening. But he calls on when he t calls on the radio, he sounds so excited. You know, like my radio number is 370, and he'll be like, blah 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 370, and you're like, holy crap, is he getting his butt whooped or something? Or, oh no, he's just calling for chow numbers. Oh, wow,
Well,
calm
for
down.
Pete's sake. He's hyper, huh?
Yeah, but he always sounds like he's in the midst of an emergency, and you're just like, oh my God.
Well,
Which
what's going to happen when he is?
I
Y'all
don't
going to
know.
say, well, that's just the way he is? What if he really is in trouble sometime?
Well, that's what worries. That's what
Can you not
worries me.
tell him about that and
Wait.
say, well, give some kind of code or something if you're really in trouble, or
Well, there is a code, but
yeah.
I don't know, man, because usually whenever somebody's in trouble, you can barely make out what they're saying because everything's all happening at once, and they're just like, da 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 da, M unit. Okay, we'll just start running off the M unit.
Oh, me. But that would worry you though, if you're somebody's calling in all hyper and everything, and it's like, okay, you're in trouble. Lassie falling in the well again? What is Lassie falling in the well again? Is a little boy falling in the well again? Or I don't know. You know what I
Yeah,
mean.
I do. And you bring up a good point. Maybe we just don't understand it no more, 'cause back then Lassie could bark a few times and they knew exactly what she was saying. Good girl. You know?
Yeah,
T Timmy,
exactly.
what's that? You know, Timmy's laying on the side of the road on East 72 in Broadway. What? You know? Good girl, you got help, Lassie.
Dialed the rotary phone
With a claw.
with a claw, with a dog claw. Oh, I tell you, talk about animals. I posted a couple pictures on Facebook. I know a lot of people haven't seen them, but the girls had a chair. It was kind of like a massage table, but this was a chair that they do their work in. And my cat took up residence on that chair, and even to the point of getting her favorite toys and putting them on the chair and sleeping with them.
Claimed
And she
that.
It was so crazy, and she'd hang over the back of it and look out the window, and they had some stones underneath of it and everything, and I think that was part of the attraction. She'd go over there and lay by the stones, and I think she liked all the energy and everything. And then she loved Nick White. I tell you, I've never seen this cat. Oh shoot! Sorry,
And
sorry.
there's the cat now.
Yeah, there's the cat now. Sorry.
Oh, no, that's okay.
She followed him around like a dog. He could not go up the steps or in another room that she wasn't right on his heels. And he played with her and played with her and played with her. Well, excuse me, these.
Oh, that's okay. Do you need to take that? We can go to our
No,
first
I keep
our first news
trying
break.
to get it to quit being loud, and it won't. It won't go
It's your fans.
Well, I'm sorry, they know I have a show to do. All my, I've got all my people here.
Well, we're at 8:20. Why don't we just go to our first news break, and then when we come back, we'll be joined by Lynn Russell, and you can finish telling us about it.
Telling you about what?
Well, you was talking about your cat.
Oh, I was just saying that my
Oh.
cat really loved Nick White.
So he's got another confirmed fan.
He does. He does. So.
Oh boy. Well, there there it is. Well, everybody, we will be right back. Just bear with us, and when we come back, we'll be joined by Lynn Russell. So everybody, just stick with us, and we will be right back.
heard on the news about that 5-year-old who found his uncle's gun. The kid didn't know it was loaded.
I heard on the news about that 14-year-old girl who was bullied online. For like a year, she couldn't take it anymore, so she got her dad's gun from his nightstand.
I heard on the news about that guy who broke into someone's house, stole a gun from the hall closet.
He accidentally shot his cousin in the head.
She killed herself.
And later, killed the owner of the store he was trying to rob.
If you own a gun, you have a full-time responsibility. When you aren't using it, be sure it can't get into the hands of curious children, troubled teenagers, a thief, or anyone else who might misuse it. Your family, friends, and neighbors are all counting on you. Remember, always lock it up. For more information on firearm storage safety, visit ncpc.org. This message brought to you by the National Crime Prevention Council, the Bureau of Justice Assistance, and the Ad Council.
Fox News Radio, I'm Jane Metzler, a 25-year-old woman now facing 4 counts of second-degree murder and a DUI charge. A judge setting bond at $1 million for Adacia Chambers, also ordering a psychiatric evaluation after she plowed her car into a crowd at Oklahoma State's homecoming parade Saturday.
Her father, Floyd Chambers, doesn't believe she was drunk.
No, I'm not going to believe that until they show me proof. I just couldn't believe that. Not from her.
Neither does her lawyer, who told reporters she may be mentally ill and unaware of what she's accused of doing.
Fox Radio's Evan Brown, a prosecutor, calling it an intentional act. The number dead now at 263 after a powerful 7.5 magnitude earthquake hit Pakistan and Afghanistan. Most of the casualties in Pakistan. The U.S. and other countries offering help, Pakistani officials say they don't need any. California made it legal earlier this month. Now the issue of assisted suicide being argued before New Mexico's highest court.
A lower court judge in New Mexico had sided with a cancer patient who fought for assisted suicide, but the state attorney general opposed it, and an appeals court overturned the lower court ruling. Now both sides have battled it out before the state Supreme Court. An attorney for the cancer patient said technology and advances in medicine mean people are living longer, the terminally ill ones often in pain. The state attorney general says making this a right should be left up to lawmakers, not the courts, and that it could put doctors who prescribe life-ending drugs in dicey legal positions.
Fox Radio's Jessica Rosenthal. Remnants of Hurricane Patricia heading east and out of Texas. The storm caused major flooding, especially in the Houston area. Some 30 water rescues, no fatalities. Fox News Radio, fair and balanced.
Okay, gang. So, chances are there'll never be an emergency ever, ever again.
Mm-hmm.
But just in case, let's talk about a plan.
Okay.
So, who's going to do what? Anyone? Yeah, okay, perfect. We'll figure it out as we go. So, who is going to grab the go bag?
What's a go bag?
It is a bag we do not have that is filled with things we really, really need in an emergency.
Guess we won't have to worry about it then.
Ah, good point. So, we all know who to call if something happens then, right?
I'd have to call Jill, Devin, Melissa, Karen, and Bruce.
And I will try to call all of you, but Greg doesn't have a cell phone. Dad's phone will have a dead battery.
No doubt.
And Julie will be on the phone with Jill, Devin, Melissa, Karen, and Bruce.
Well, this is great. I am so glad that we don't have a plan.
I know.
Winging It is not an emergency plan. Make sure your kids know what to do during an emergency, who to call, where to meet, what to pack. Visit ready.gov/kids for tips and information. A public service announcement brought to you by FEMA and the Ad Council.
Could avoid a government shutdown. An agreement on a federal budget said to be close.
It would likely fund the government until next October. It would also address a massive Medicare premium hike set to take effect next year. And it would adjust automatic cuts to both defense and domestic programs. At the White House, Press Secretary Josh Earnest told reporters it isn't totally done yet.
We have worked assiduously to protect the privacy and confidentiality of those discussions. Principally because they're based on this principle that nothing is agreed to in the context of those discussions until everything is agreed to.
On Capitol Hill, Mike Emanuel, Fox News Radio.
The U.S. sending a Navy ship to within 12 miles of some man-made islands in disputed waters in the South China Sea. Should the Obama administration decide to intervene militarily?
The USS Lassen, a Navy destroyer, is the closest American warship in position to carry out the operation, which sources say could be ordered within 24 hours. Senior Pentagon officials were angered by the leak. The Spratly Islands are artificial islands that China has been building up, adding miles of shoreline and laying down what look like military runways. President Obama met with the Indonesian president at the White House to discuss the effort to defeat ISIS and concerns about Chinese aggression in the South China Sea. Defense Secretary Ash Carter and Chairman of the Joint Chiefs General Joe Dunford leave for Asia on Friday. At the Pentagon, Jennifer Griffin, Fox News Radio.
A new federal rule prohibits airline passengers from packing electronic cigarettes or other battery-operated e-smoking devices in their checked bags to protect against in-flight fires. They are still allowed in carry-ons. U.S. markets ending lower, the Dow down 24, the NASDAQ off 3, the S&P down 4. I'm Jane Metzler, Fox News Radio.
You are listening to The Buzz on the ZTalk Radio Network. Imagine the possibilities. Now back to the show with Kevin Thompson and Molly Spence. The best in alternative talk radio.
All right, everybody, we are back. You are listening to The Buzz on ztalkradio.com. And since we've already introduced her, everybody, say hello to Lynn Russell. Lynn, welcome to the show. How are you?
I'm wonderful. Thank you for inviting me.
We are honored to have you. And Molly, like we were saying off air, we just have recently had, we've had Johnny Clark on. And now we've got Lynn, and she has investigated over 2,500 near-death experiences. Lynn, how did you get started, or tell us a little bit about what you do and how you got started doing this?
Well, I was I've been fascinated with near-death experiences, and I was on the net with a near death experience site, and it's called NDERF, which is Near Death Experience Research Foundation, and so the man who owns it, which was Dr. Long, Jeff Long, he asked for somebody to do research for him, so I volunteered. That was about 10 years ago. And so I volunteered, and I had no idea. I was always interested in near-death experiences, but I had no idea that I was going to get all this marvelous information that just was coming to me, so I just had to write a book about it. Yeah.
So how, you, I mean, 2,500, that is a lot. How do you find this many people with near-death experiences? Do they come to you, or how did this happen?
Excuse me. Well, what happened was that they would come to Dr. Long's site, and they would, and that's a research site, and so they would enter their near-death experience in there and answer a questionnaire. And then my job was to take read through their experience and then tear apart their experience and put it into categories.
So are there different categories of near death?
Well, categories from the point of view of how many people, because my research was for Dr. Long's book, which is Evidence of the Afterlife. And so that was what the original plan was, to do his research for his book. But so I would look at how many people had a tunnel experience, how many people went to an earth-like experience, so how many people went to light, that kind of thing. So I tore it apart in that way.
Are there that many people that have near-death experiences?
Oh, my goodness, yes. There's thousands. The world, I would say that there's probably millions in the world. But in the United States, there's like 30,000 or more. And those experiences from that site and the ERF were all from around the whole world. And so now they've got like 5,000 or more.
Wow.
Yeah, lots and lots.
So, I mean, I've heard of that, a lot of people having them, but I didn't know that it was that prevalent. I think that if you, not that many people come back that die,
Well, I think as medical science becomes more efficient, they can bring more people back.
Mm-hmm.
So they're learning how to do a lot more than they did.
Wow.
Yeah. It's exciting. I love it. I've learned so much. It's wonderful.
I was going to say that would be very interesting to hear. Can you tell us some of the stories?
And then after I wrote the book, which is called The Wonder of You, What the Near-Death Experience Tells You About Yourself. And then I wrote the book, and now I have developed some a workshop to go with it. So let me put my glasses on here. Okay, my first major chapter was, were they really dead? Because one of the big questions is that, were they just pretending, or, were they for real, and the doubters. And so I have some stories about people. There's a little girl here, Rosemary, and she's 12 years old, and she had spinal meningitis, and she died. And when she came back, her blood was frozen. And so it was very painful for her to get her body, her blood, to warm up again and start moving. So basically, she was in rigor mortis when she was brought back. Yeah. There's amazing. Many people have been brought back when they're in the morgue. And one man was brought back when they started to do an autopsy on him.
Oh my heavens.
Yeah,
I can't imagine.
Yeah, he's famous. Yeah, that's Jim. George. Yeah, Rod, I can never say his last name. It's a big, there it is. Rodonaia. And he's quite famous. He's on. You can Google him, and you would get him.
So he was on the autopsy table, and they were getting ready to cut into him, and he came back.
Yes.
Oh
yes.
My God! Yes. What if you came back during an autopsy?
Oh, wouldn't that be awful?
He said that they started to make the cut, and that's when he woke up.
Mm.
Don't ask me. It seems strange to me, too.
Yeah. Well, I know back in the day, before all the medical science and everything else, when someone they thought was dead, and they put a bell on there, and that's where...
Yes, that's right. They could sing it, yeah.
Yeah, and then that way, if they came back while they were in the grave, where the word dead ringer came from.
That's right.
Yes. Well, actually, I think that's why they started to do embalmments and things like
mm-hmm.
that.
Give them a chance to come back.
Yeah, just to make sure.
So having said that, Lynn, and given us these examples, what actually constitutes a near-death experience?
Okay, a near-death experience is someone who has, for various reasons, died, and has been brought back. Usually they're brought back. Sometimes they come back spontaneous. That does happen as well. And, for example, there was one woman in, she was in the, morgue, and, her brother-in-law was there to identify her. And while he was looking at her, he said to the nurse, "Do dead people cry?" And then they realized that she had come back on her own. So, yeah, people sometimes come back on their own, but they're told that, they have to come back, that it's time. You know, that they're not finished here, that they have a goal that they've set for themselves before they've come, and so they have to come back to fulfill that goal.
Oh, so it's almost like goal orientation.
Well, no, it's mostly to do with giving. It's very complicated. We are created by the Creator or by a source or by God, whatever name you call it. And our job is to give meaning or to give, I don't know how to explain this, to give experience to the source so that's what our job is. And we're here to learn to love. That's our main goal, is to learn to love. And then we can return back to the source. But we have to learn that lesson. And so what happens is that we make a goal or a task that we have to do when we come here, and then we choose what we're going to look like, what race we're going to be, what country, what kind of parents, where we're going to be, the economics, everything. And all the things that would have an impact on our lives to direct us to that goal. And also we get help from our guides. So the main purpose is to get that goal done in this light. But you don't have to do it in this light, because we do have free will. And so we can take 4 or 5 lives we want.
Wow, that is kind of complicated, but it's understandable. Molly, this is very much what Tamara and Donette was saying a couple weeks back.
Mm-hmm.
That we can choose our next life to an extent.
Yeah, we choose.
We make a contract coming into this life. And I think I said, don't we make a contract coming into this life, and then that, and we have to fulfill that. And if we die before our time, we're sent back.
Yeah, then we have to keep
finish the contract.
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. It is very exciting. But what I loved about it was how beautiful we are, and the book talks about the oneness and that we're part of that oneness. And that's the main purpose of the book. And then, as I said, I've also developed a workshop that talks about our reality and how beautiful we are.
Mm-hmm.
Now, going back, you stated a little bit ago that, you know, I understand that we're one with everybody. But when you pass on, have you had anybody experience like being tied to their body or being joined with, what's the words I'm looking for? Do they experience that oneness?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Oh, yes, very strongly. Most of them do. That's one of the things that they do. The first thing they feel is a sense of calm and peace, and it's okay. They're not in pain anymore at all. And so they say, well, that's okay, you know. They feel okay about what's happening. And some of them know that they've died, and some don't, but they figure it out. And yes, that's talked about a lot, is that they feel that they are not only a part of each other, but a part of the whole universe. And if they go to the light, they become a part of the light as well. So they become not a part of one with. They become the light.
They have become, any of... I'm sorry, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, they become the universe.
Have any of them had a negative experience?
Oh, yes, I've had some negative experiences as well. Usually what happens with the negative experiences is that it's what they think they deserve. And so we create our own negative experiences. We create it completely ourselves. And that's because that's what we think we deserve. And so once they recognize that they don't deserve that, or very often they'll say, help me, and then they get help and they're out right away.
Oh, wow.
I wonder if some of the ones that actually that do cross over and don't come back, if that's how they feel, like they are stuck in that realm.
Oh, no, they never feel stuck because it's so beautiful there. They are absolutely wrapped in this magnificent blanket of love. And it's really so beautiful, they never want to come back. Mm-hmm. They fight not to have to come back when they do. But, I mean, that they're not finished yet. There's something.
Yeah.
Maybe it's not, like, maybe it's just raising their children. But it may be something bigger, too, you know, mm-hmm. that they're do that'll have an effect on the rest of society. So it can be something small or it can be something big.
Mm-hmm. No, I was talking about the ones that were having the negative experience. That might be why they feel like they're stuck, because they think they deserve whatever it is that they're getting.
Yeah. For example, one man was gay, and so when he died, he went to a hell kind of, or a negative kind of place, and because he thought that that's what should happen to him because he was gay. And then, I don't know, I think there is his experience because he didn't stay there. None of them ever stay there. They're always taken back out of that situation, at least the ones that I ever talked to, learned about. And so he was taken out of there, and he was told that, no, it's okay, you're fine. You know, there's nothing mm-hmm. wrong with you. So that was cool.
So we are... would you say that it's a fair assessment that how we feel now about ourselves sets us up for what we experience in the afterlife?
Oh, I think it's the most important thing is giving to others. And that, but you're right, it does. You are right that, yes, how you feel about yourself also affects the kind of afterlife you're going to have. Although, as I say, they don't stay there. They only go there for a short time. What normally happens is they have a life review, and the life review, they go over their life, and they do their own judging. It's themselves that they look at what they have done and say, oh, that was really good, I'm glad I did that, and feel really good about themselves. Or they look at what they've done and say, gee, I shouldn't have. You know, I shouldn't have done that, and what did I learn from that experience for the future?
Do you think they go into, you know, should they keep on, you know, not come back, and they are in that thought form, do you think that they believe that God's going to put them in a rehabilitation program or something sort of, you know, to get them back on track again before they go on to the light?
Well, one of the things that I found with 99.9% of the people is that when they die as a human being. They die with their personality and their ego. They take the whole package with them.
Mm-hmm.
So it takes them a little bit of time to realize that they are spirit, and because many, many people put themselves into a physical surroundings with a garden or mountains or a beach or that kind of thing. You know, like they're in a physical kind of place. And that's because they still see themselves as being a physical being. And so once they realize that they're spirit, then they can start to let go of the past life, take the learning that they've had, and move on from there.
Wow. Now, we actually have a couple of listeners that are in the chat room right now with a couple of questions. One is asking how many of these individuals that experience near death since they were dead, physically dead, do many of them actually suffer any type of brain damage when they come back, or is healing part of that coming back process?
And that's a good question, because under normal circumstances, there would be brain damage, but these people don't have any. They come back completely together. And as a matter of fact, many of them come back with skills or talents or abilities that they didn't have before. So they might be able to be psychic. They might have musical skills that they never, you know, they can talk a language they've never talked before. So they come back with some kind of skill or talent that they never had before.
Wow. So it comes back with, they come back with gifts. Yeah, a benefits package.
They don't come back with brain damage, which is what the question was. So, No, they don't. They're very together, just like they normally were before.
And one of our listeners is mentioning that she has had two near-death experiences, but can only remember one. Do you have many that come back and don't remember anything?
Oh, yes. But I don't, you see, those people wouldn't be in my study because they didn't report their near-death experience to Dr. Long's site because they didn't remember it, so they couldn't report it. So I would only know the ones who do remember.
Because you're studying the experience in and of itself.
I'm sorry, did you repeat that?
So you were actually studying the death experience in and of itself.
Yes. That's right. That's exactly right.
So here's this is a curiosity question for myself. Because I keep going back to this, Lynn, and I'm sorry. A very dear friend of mine and I were talking this past week about our, you know, how we see ourselves, our self-image. So if we have a poor self-image of ourselves now, would we experience something similar in the afterlife? Would we set ourselves up for a bad experience, or would we be healed of that and come back better?
Yeah, no, you would not necessarily wind up with a negative experience. Usually what happens is that those people are wrapped up in such amount of love that they can't, I mean, it's love that can't even be talked about because there are no words to experience it, to express it. One of my people said that they were talking about spirit, and there's no language for that, which is right. But usually they are given all kinds of warm fuzzies and love and caring. So, no, they don't wind up with a negative experience just because they feel bad about themselves.
So, wow. I'm just sitting here wondering if we start, let's just call it like de-stressing, meditating, and getting ourselves together here in the living experience, would we carry that over and have like almost a heavenly experience, or would it amplify that?
Well, let me tell you about a lady that I had that, actually, I talked to her a number of times. She committed suicide. She knew before she committed suicide that she was doing wrong. She had been taught, I think she was Catholic, and she taught was taught that that was a sin.
Yes.
And so she was expecting to go to a hell-like kind of experience. But instead, she wound up in the light, being surrounded by love. And so she said, and I have this in the book, she said to the light, what am I doing here? I committed suicide. I shouldn't be here. And the love, the light just loved her more back. You know, it just, it was a very warm, loving experience.
Because she was being honest.
Yes, she was, yes. Mm-hmm. And, yeah. And it was a beautiful experience, and I have her in there a couple of times because her story was so beautiful. Mm-hmm. Debbie Sue. DW, I think I have it.
Debbie D-W. Sue. Is she from here in Alabama with us?
I don't know. Actually, she's not with us anymore. She died. She's passed on.
No, oh, that's too bad. I take that back. Then I wasn't making fun, but
oh,
Debbie
no,
Sue.
No, that's okay. Not a problem.
Usually, a double name like that is more recognized in the South than elsewhere. So.
Yes. And so she was shocked that she was being treated. I'm just turning to her page now, but she was really quite shocked that she was being treated so well, given that she had committed suicide. So, you know, I just don't think there's a set pattern. Debbie Sue, that's the name. Mm-hmm. No two experiences are alike. And that's a very important point, because one experience will have this element and this element and this element and not have the other things. And then the next time, if they have a second death, they can have other elements and not have the first one. So it's different for each person.
But that's actually very, very, very comforting.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right.
So are we affected, and again, this is probably, I'm asking this just simply for purely selfish reasons.
Mm-hmm.
If you have certain things that you've done in your life that you can't forgive yourself for, would you receive that forgiveness on the other side and then come back and feel relief?
Yes. I suggest that Damien Brinkley is a good read on that one. Damien has had two or three near-death experiences. But anyway, the first one was because he was lightning hit him. And so he was a mercenary with the American Army and had murdered people. And when he was on the other side, he was told those people were, you know, it was, he was told that there were plans for those people in this life and that now they had to come back and do it all over again to finish off their plan. And so when Damien Brinkley died the second time, he went through the same experience and re-saw those kind of things. So I don't know. I don't think it's there's one package that fits all. I think it's very individual. But I would think that if remorse is there, that's what I would say, that if remorse is there, that it probably, you know, you would probably be, you know, wrapped up in love.
Okay.
We all have done things that we wish we hadn't, every one mm-hmm. of us. You know, that's just part of being a human being.
But don't you think if we ask ourselves, if we look in a mirror and ask ourselves to forgive us, that doesn't, clear us with God?
I think if you look at what you've done, this is my own personal view based on what I've learned, okay? Mm-hmm. I think that if you looked at what you've done and you said, I really wish I hadn't done that, I'm really sorry, and I feel awful, then I think that's all that's necessary. Whether yes. you forgive yourself or not is another story, but the fact mm-hmm. that you feel remorseful, recognize that that wasn't a good thing to do and want to move on, that's the bitter. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, thank you for that, Lynn. And I'm asking, you know, I asked that as a combat veteran. And, you know, you think about that. And since, you know, I've tried to live my life as a very good man, you know, honest man with sure. integrity and help others. And, you know, I do, you know, worship God, you know, with all of my heart. And I do what I feel He's telling me to do. But you've always got that in the back of your mind. And
yeah.
and when you said that sometimes you carry those things into the other world and it affects your experience, you know, you could see where somebody would get worried about that.
Yeah, that's a good question. That's a good question. Because, you know, I think if you honestly are remorseful, because, how do I explain this? We can be recreated again. Okay, we are one with everything, and including the light, including the Creator. And so you can't damage the Creator. You can't kill it. You know, you can't kill God. And so, and you're part of that because God created you, and God is love, so you are love. Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You are love energy. That's what you are. That's what we all are. We are love energy. Because God is love. And so we're created by God through His love energy. And so He creates us. And then, but we can't be destroyed because we're spirit, because we're connected. So even if somebody doesn't complete their life in this life, they will come back and finish it.
That is beautiful. Lynn, you put that so beautifully. One more question before we go to our next break. And by the way, speaking of questions, if you guys have questions that you would like to ask yourself, we do invite you to call. That number is 262-672-2488. Because how often do we get the chance to find out what's on the other side?
Okay.
And yeah, and get to ask the expert, 2,500 cases.
Yeah, that's a lot.
Yes. Well, I was so fascinated with what I was learning. I just didn't want to stop. even after that, I thought, well, I better stop now. But I really didn't want to, because even now I will read new near-death experiences, even though it's things that I already know. But I still want to hear, you know, because they're always different, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's cool.
Mine is fruitcake. Once I get started, I just can't stop.
Oh, yeah, right.
But the question...
He's the only one in the world that likes fruitcake.
Oh, my gosh, I love it. I can't see. This is exciting because it's coming up in 2 more months, Christmas, and that's when they have them. But a listener has sent me a question. We've been talking a lot about near-death experiences with adults, and you did mention one young child whose blood was frozen. But do these experiences seem to be different for children rather than adults?
No, not really, because children are spirit the same as we are spirit, and spirit doesn't have an age. And so when we go back, whatever age we were, we are spirit age. We're not, you know, there is no time or space there. There's just isness. So I have one little boy. I love him. I just love this kid. I don't know what his name is. I'd have to look it up. But he was a little rascal, and he was going to have his near death, like he was going to have his life review. And he said, oh, well, that's all right. I'm to himself. He's saying, that's all right. I'm a kid. I can't have done that much bad. And so, the guide or the angel that was with him answered and said, well, you know, you wait and see. And he said, oh, God, they can remember. So he was really upset that they could hear him thinking. Anyway, he did experience a normal life review from the moment that he was born until he died. And that's what we all do.
Do any of these children, when they come back from a near-death experience, do they feel like they've come back into this lifetime again, or do they think they've been reincarnated?
No, they would come into this lifetime just like other people. But there are people who are, I mean, some people remember their reincarnation, but most of us don't.
Well, my grandson does, so that's why I was asking about that.
If we remembered our past lives, we wouldn't be able to function properly in this life.
Mm-hmm. Well, he had talked about it, you know, when he was small, under 2 years old, but he started talking quite young. Yeah. And told several stories. He had like four different stories that he told me. And one of them, the first time he said anything, he said, when I was 4 years old before, I died in a fire.
Oh, dear.
So, you know, and that really worried my daughter for a while. But I told her, I said, he's remembering a past life.
Yes. Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. And that's great, very possible. I mean, children do remember much easier than as we get older, we start to forget.
Yeah. They haven't been gone that long. It's all new to them.
Well, guys, why don't we go to our next news break, and then when we come back, Lynn, I'm kind of hoping that you'll walk us through an average near-death experience. What are the steps?
Okay. All right. I can do that.
Okay, well, everybody, you are listening to The Buzz on ztalkradio.com. And when we come back, if you'd like to ask your questions or make comments or maybe tell us one of your own near-death experience stories, that number is 262-672-2488. And just stick right with us.
Driving has a rhythm all its own. Don't wreck it with a text. Before you get behind the wheel, silence your phone. Or better yet, designate a texter. For more text-free driving tips, visit stoptextstopwrecks.org. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration.
This podcast and the following message are made possible by Squarespace, providing online tools for individuals and businesses to create a website. Squarespace includes hosting, 24/7 customer support, domains, e-commerce, and more. Visit squarespace.com/NPR for a free trial.
From NPR News in Washington, I'm Jack Spear. Pakistan says it will not be issuing calls for any international assistance in the wake of a 7.5 preliminary magnitude earthquake that hit the northern part of that country today. All told, authorities say nearly 200 people have died in Pakistan and neighboring Afghanistan. Speaking at the White House today, Press Secretary Josh Earnest said there are assets in the region that could help if the government there wants to utilize them.
There are a number of pre-positioned emergency shelter and relief supply kits in warehouses throughout Afghanistan. And in Pakistan, USAID has existing partners who are ready to respond if necessary.
Shockwaves from the powerful tremor were felt as far away as New Delhi. The death toll could rise. Some of the damage likely occurred in the rugged Hindu Kush Mountains. Relatively deep earthquake was centered about 158 miles northeast of Kabul. European Union leaders are agreeing to make room for another 100,000 people at migrant registration camps in Greece and the Balkans. Joanna Kakissis reports the entrance of migrants into Europe has overwhelmed some smaller countries.
Thousands of people cross the sea from Turkey to Greece every day. Many are stuck at a camp on the island of Lesbos. It's crowded, muddy, and filled with trash. Amani Almosuti is from Damascus, Syria.
You can see now how dirty it is. And it's raining, and they didn't even ask us if we need anything to cover us from the rain.
European Union leaders agreed on Sunday to expand reception facilities. Greece will host an additional 30,000 people by the end of the year. Balkan countries will provide space for another 50,000. Most migrants are trying to reach Germany and Scandinavia. For NPR News, I'm Joanna Kakissis.
The woman suspected of crashing her car into a crowd of people at Oklahoma State University's homecoming parade Saturday made her first appearance in court today. As Rachel Hubbard of member station KOSU reports, four people are dead, including a two-year-old child. Dozens were hurt.
The state asked for a two-week delay before officially charging Adacia Avery Chambers with four counts of murder in the second degree. Prosecutors say she willfully drove her car into a crowd of people. But her attorney, Tony Coleman, says she has been hospitalized for mental illness in the past and appears to be struggling with it again.
Her response was inconsistent and inappropriate is the best way I can describe it.
Coleman says Chambers doesn't seem to understand that she killed people. She appeared in court via video conference with her head down and barely acknowledged the judge when asked if she understood what was happening. For NPR News, I'm Rachel Hubbard in Stillwater, Oklahoma.
Sales of new homes took a dip last month. The Commerce Department reporting new home sales fell 11.5% to a seasonally adjusted 468,000 units. Purchases of new homes were down in every part of the country. On Wall Street, a mixed close. The Dow dropped 23 points to 17,623. The Nasdaq was up 2 points. The Standard & Poor's 500 closed down 3 points today. You're listening to NPR News in Washington. The state flag has come down at Ole Miss. Officials at the University of Mississippi today quietly removing the flag with its Confederate battle emblem from its place of honor on the campus. Students and faculty alike had said they felt the flag had become a divisive symbol, weakening efforts to promote diversity, tolerance, and respect at the university. Since 1894, the Mississippi flag has had the Confederate battle emblem in the upper left corner, a blue X with 13 stars over a field of red. Washington, D.C. radio legend Ed Walker, who earned fame as one of the Joy Boys of local radio, died early this morning. We have more from Kathy Goldergeier of member station WAMU.
Ed Walker has been a fixture on D.C. radio for 60 years. In the 50s and 60s, he and his longtime collaborator Willard Scott spoofed politicians on radio stations in the nation's capital. For the past 25 years, Walker hosted the big broadcast on WAMU, bringing old-time radio to today's listeners.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to another edition of the Big Broadcast. My name is Ed Walker.
Walker was born blind and embraced radio as a boy. He was recently diagnosed with cancer and recorded his most recent broadcast in the hospital. That show aired Sunday night. He listened to it with his family and died a few hours later. For NPR News, I'm Kathy Goldgeier in Washington.
In Iowa and some other states, transportation systems are actually getting smaller. One big reason, in many cases, cash-strapped municipalities and states are being forced to make hard choices about which roads to maintain. Warren County, south of Des Moines, officials say they've shut down 20 bridges over small streams, with more likely to come. I'm Jack Spear, NPR News.
From the latest newscast to the newest podcast, NPR One handpicks local, national, and international stories based on what you like. Download the NPR One app, a new way to experience public radio.
We'll be right back.
Okay, everybody, we are back. You are listening to The Buzz on ztalkradio.com. Our guest tonight is Lynn Russell. She's an expert who has studied over 2,500 near-death experiences. And here in just a few moments, she's going to kind of walk us through what a general near-death experience is, or what it's like, or some of the commonalities. But first, before we went to break, Lynn brought up something that I think is very important. It's very sensitive and probably will speak to a lot of people. What happens after a suicide? She mentioned that one of her cases was a Catholic who, knowing Catholicism the way I do, I know that they do teach in old Catholicism that suicide is one of the only sins that you cannot ask forgiveness for because you have taken your own life. So how does suicide affect their experiences, Lynn?
Well, I learned that there are three choices that the person who has attempted or committed suicide has. The first choice is that if they can, they are sent back and to work out the issue and see if they can find a way to do it without suicide. The second thing that is that they can, if their body is too damaged and they can come back into it, then they can stay at the spirit level, but they have to work out. They have to go over and over and over the suicide, the conditions that led up to the suicide, and try and figure out a way that they could have worked it out without suicide. And then the third option is reincarnation, where they would be brought back and they have the exact same circumstances that they've tried to get away from. And so the bottom line is that people who commit suicide do not get out of whatever the issue is that they're trying to get away from. They don't. They still have to take responsibility for their actions and for, you know, whatever it was they were trying to avoid.
Oh boy, that would really kind of suck, really. The last choice.
Yeah, I think it sucks. No, I did hear from another radio that I did an interview, and apparently one of the listeners called in after the show and said that she had been thinking of suicide, and when I told her that, she decided she wasn't going to do it. So that's cool. It is, yes, the most painful kind of death for those who are left behind. So I'm glad that she didn't.
Mm-hmm.
And I can see why, too, because you're basically telling your family that you weren't worth living for, that the circumstances I'm facing was worse than what you could do for me.
Well, most of the people who are thinking of leaving, they're leaving. They're not leaving the family. They're just leaving the circumstance. Like, you know, they're depressed or they have lost hope. Basically, they've lost hope. It's never going to get any better. A big one is teenagers. Teenagers are very volatile with their emotions, and so there's a high incidence of teen suicide.
Well, yeah, but they may not understand that. I mean, you are a family therapist with 30 years of experience under your belt, but the average family's not going to understand that.
No, but the child, what I want them to understand is that they can't get away from whatever it is that they're trying to avoid, that they have to face the music, mm-hmm. that they've made choices, and these are the choices they have to live up to them. And that maybe the choices are made before they came into this life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they wrote that into their script.
Yeah, could be. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes people want to jump in there and save people, but maybe that's what they've asked for, is to live a life in under those circumstances. Mm-hmm. We don't know. You know, it certainly it's up to us to reach out and help as much as we possibly can. But if it doesn't work, then that's too bad. You know, it's a shame, but there's not much you can do about it.
So you got to face the music either way. You either have to stay here and go through whatever you're going through, or you have to do it on the other side.
Boy. So now you want me to tell you what an average? Well, that's what pretty much what my book does. It takes it from the beginning of what, you know, the first things that happen, and goes step by step through to an average death. Having said that, again, no two near-death experiences are exactly alike. For example, the very first thing often is a tunnel. So people will see a tunnel in front of them and they find themselves being pulled through the tunnel. Some people don't have a tunnel at all. Some people immediately go right to the light. Other people will go to, after they've gotten out of the tunnel, they might see the light, or they might go to a beautiful earth-like location. So it could be the mountain, it could be a beautiful beach, it could be the ocean, it could be just a beautiful garden. And that's common, is to do that. And one of the beautiful things about that is that the water and the vegetation and even the rocks send off love. So if you talk or think about that whatever it is, you know, the flower or the water or whatever, it will love you. And I think that's cool. I think that's amazing. All right, so then when the people finish the tunnel and they arrive at wherever they're going to be, they have a life review. No, sometimes they meet relatives first. So they will meet either a guide or they will meet a relative, and the relatives will spend some warm, fuzzy time together. It's really quite nice. And then they'll have the life review. And so, as I say, you do your own judging. You are not judged. As a matter of fact, when the people are going through the life review, they are being surrounded with all kinds of love and support, so that they're not being told, what's the matter with you, or why did you do that? None of that. And the bottom line is, as I said before, that it isn't how horrible you are, it's what you learned from it. So if you've made a mistake and you've done things that you wish you hadn't done, what did you learn from that experience? And how can you use that to better yourself and to help others? Because that's big, to help others. And then some people are shown around or allowed to spend time in the garden, or they are shown around with their guide or something like that. And then they will be told that it's time for them to come back. I don't know very many people. I think I only read one that said before they were told that they have to come back, they said, oh, I have to go back. I'm not finished. But always they argue. They do not want to come back. They want to stay. They want to do, you know, because it's so beautiful there. It's just so wonderful. And so they it's like more love than they've ever felt in their life. Their mother didn't love them that much. And so they don't want to leave it. But of course they're told, well, you pretty well have to, because you've got things you have to do there. I had a very brief near-death experience where mine was so small, it's hardly worth mentioning, except that I went into a tunnel. There was a guide there with me, and the two of us were going up through the tunnel, and this loud voice, very booming, came down and said, take her back, it's not her time. And so the fellow with me, the guide, it was a guy, man. And he said, but she died. And so the voice said, take her back. She has much left to do. And the next thing I know, I was back in my body. And, wow. Yeah, so, but you don't have a choice. You have to come back.
Wow. Ah, now here's a question I've been wanting to ask, and you've led into it perfectly. And Molly, we've asked this before. Do you think, because Molly and I are ghost hunters, and we go to haunted locations and investigate, and oftentimes have actually met spirits. Do you think it's possible that they were on the other side and attempted to come back, and something stopped that transition of coming back, and now they could be stuck between worlds?
No, that wouldn't happen. What would maybe happen, though, is that they never went through the tunnel or through, they never went beyond the earth. They don't even maybe know that they're dead. You know, there are some who stick around. Then they may stick around for their children, or they may stick around because of some
choice.
Something they're very strongly connected to here. Mm-hmm. So they would never have left in the first place.
So what would stop them?
Well,
like
stop
Molly
themselves.
Said, a choice?
They refuse to accept that they're dead.
It's just choice.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, the choice.
Do you feel that? I mean, I'm not disagreeing or being obstinate, but do you think that? Well, wait a minute. You are saying the same thing, that if they did go to be with God, but they're like, listen, I really miss my family. That being a loving God, that He would allow them maybe to come back.
Probably not as a ghost. Because I, right this minute, can be surrounded by family that are supportive to me, that are my guides are here, you know, people that love me, that care about me, that want to be with me through. I know for a fact that people who have passed on know what's happening in your life. So they don't need to come back and become a ghost. Mm-hmm. They can already see it from where they are.
Yeah. I agree with that.
Yeah, they will often turn around and look, and there they can see their family, or they can see themselves in the bed and the doctor they're working on them and things like that. And they're up or wherever they go, you know. They're already at the place where they're going to go, but they just turn around and there it is. Mm-hmm. So they can connect without becoming a ghost. And I don't know why people would want to be a ghost, to be honest. It's so beautiful.
Well,
you want to be here.
But don't you think sometimes that since it is a choice and they felt like maybe they have done wrong in their lifetime, that they're afraid of what God may do to them or the punishment or, you know, just what may happen to them in general? You know, if they're not of faith or whatever, that they would worry about what would happen.
Well, I'm sure that certainly could happen, but I never run across anything like that, and so I guess I can't talk to it, but it just doesn't make sense in my brain to what I've learned. But that doesn't mean it doesn't, you know. Maybe it does. It just doesn't make sense because they as I've said before, they are so wrapped in love and support and caring that I can't imagine that they would feel that God's mad at them and they want to come back. That just doesn't fit.
Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Now your book it teaches about what your near-death experience tells you about yourself. Is this what you want? Or I mean, I'm sorry, I'm looking at somebody just shot me a comment. Is this the type of things that you discuss in your workshops. Tell us a little bit about your workshops and how that ties in.
My workshop takes this book one step farther. The book, what I discovered through the book, I already believed in the oneness. I really did already believe in that. And the book, the first chapter of the book, actually it's a prologue, talks about a spiritual experience that I had that taught me about the oneness. So I already knew about the oneness. But it's sort of like you're on the earth and it's like, yeah, is that really true? Or, you know, you question yourself. And so when I was doing the research, it was jumping out at me over and over. You know, people were saying I was one with the light. I was the light. I was the universe and whatever. So I and other people, you know. And so that was the big lesson that I learned from this book. And so I wanted to tell people and show people how that is possible, that they are one. But the other part, now what I've done is I have studied science. I love science. I've loved it since I was a young teenager. I know it's weird, but anyway. and so I have always, like, that's sort of a hobby to study science. And so now science is coming up with proof of our spirituality. And so that's what I'm doing in my workshop. It's science and spirituality. So that I'm talking about the science, and then I bring it to the spirituality so that people can see what their reality is. And it's about a day long. It's a five-hour workshop one day with a lunch, of course, and all that.
Ah, you got me there. I love lunch.
Too bad you're not closer.
Yes.
But, you know, we could fly to Montana every week.
Yeah, right. Well, I am right away. I'm doing them. I have four workshops coming up. One is in Lethbridge, Alberta, in January. Two are on the Vancouver Island in the first week of March, and then one in Calgary in the spring, but the date hasn't been set for that one yet.
So you're not having any workshops near
Alabama?
Near Alabama.
I'm not.
We're gonna fly away.
Actually, I have applied to be one of the presenters at a conference that's coming up in May in Arizona.
Oh, where?
Tucson.
Molly.
Aha.
Bingo.
Okay, well, I may be there. I'm trying to move to Tucson.
Right. Well, we'll come over if we're there. It's in May, and it's to do with consciousness.
Okay. Well, how about that?
You have made Molly's day.
You have. What is the date on that? Do you have that?
No, I don't have it in front of me, so I apologize about that.
Do you know where it will be held?
Yes. But it's held.
Other than Tucson?
It's run by the University of Arizona.
Okay.
So the university will be doing advertising for
it. Okay, well, I'll check their website.
Yeah, and look for consciousness study.
Studies, okay. I'm writing it down as we speak.
Okay, great.
Got it. That's awesome. Okay. Because I'm generally out there. You know, I go out every year anyway, but I'm generally there anywhere from February to May. And but hopefully I will be living there by then, and I will make a point to be there.
Well, I'd love to come up and speak to me. And
I most certainly will.
Yeah, that would be wonderful. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So any other questions on near death?
Well, of course. Molly, you go ahead.
You don't know Kevin. He will talk questions on, give you questions all night long about.
Yes, especially when I get so inspired. Like right now, I'm just the possibilities are endless. But I don't want to be, you know, monopolize. Again, let me give out that call out number because we've got about 15 minutes left with Miss Russell. That number is 262-672-2488. And quickly, time is ticking away. You only have about 15 more minutes to ask your questions.
Or so, if you have a comment.
Well, absolutely. You don't have to just put them in the chat room, but we will ask them if you put them out there. I remember, and tell me if this was a near-death experience, Lynn. I remember I was a young boy, and we were all swimming in a pool. And I remember jumping backwards. I was stupid. You know, I was a dumb kid. And I jumped.
I'm a child.
I jumped backwards and not nowhere near far enough to actually clear the edge of the pool, and I hit squarely on my chin, going down. And I remember drifting down through the water and watching my blood go up, and I was thinking, well, I'm drowning, but this doesn't feel bad at all.
Right.
And I remember going all the way to the bottom, and I'm like, this is nothing what I thought dying would be like. This isn't bad at all. This is nice. And then shortly thereafter, somebody jumped in and snatched me out of the water, and I was actually a little ticked about that. Yeah.
Well, actually, that does sort of sound like the very first step to dying. Often people, like a lot of children in my book and the ones that I've read, have died through drowning, that because they're doing things they weren't supposed to do or whatever, you know, testing the system. and so drowning is a beautiful, peaceful way to die. It sounds like it's the nicest one of all. Although when I left and went into that tunnel that time, literally, it was 1 minute I was in my body and the next minute I was nothing in between.
Wow.
Did you feel like you were floating or anything?
Yeah,
or were you did you just go from A to B?
I was flying. I was flying up the tunnel with this man. So it wasn't floating. It was more like we were going up pretty fast through the tunnel. But the important part is it was just like stepping from one room into the other.
I say that all the time.
Yeah, so that's how difficult it was. It was like nothing. Very exciting.
So do you? No. Go ahead, Molly. I'm sorry.
No, that's all right. That's okay. I was going to say something probably pretty stupid, but go ahead.
No.
Go ahead.
Well, Lynn, do you think God may have made death peaceful like that so that we wouldn't fear it and we can come back and tell others what it was like?
No, I think that it's because you're going to the light. You're going to love. You're leaving the separation, because right now we're separated. We are one, but we feel separated. I don't know what you're thinking or what you're feeling. If you get, you know, I don't know what the man across the street feels, for that matter. So we, in this life, we are separated. This is a very painful life in comparison. And so when we leave here, we're going home again. We're leaving here to go home, and it's very beautiful. So that's what I think it is.
Well, what do you think people learn from a negative experience?
I think they learn that they have choices, that they're not as bad as they think they are, that they are loved beyond what they can possibly imagine, and that they're beautiful.
It's just so hopeful now.
Yeah, it is. It is hopeful. I feel that way, too. As I say, I had an experience, a spiritual experience that's in the beginning of my book, and it was so beautiful. And one of the messages I got during that spiritual experience was that death was full of love. And I remember thinking, oh, that's what death is. When? You know? I didn't mind at all. But, of course, now life has happened.
I just happen to have a crazy thought. Are near-death experiences and out-of-body experiences similar?
Oh, I think they are. I think they're like brothers or cousins or something. near-death experiences, you would go right into the light. You would go to wherever it is, whether it's a light or whether it's the beautiful garden or whatever. You would go there, and you would have your guides, and you would. So, with OBEs or out of body experiences, you don't have the life review. You don't have the garden. Well, you might go to somewhere nice, but I doubt that.
Right.
You do feel warm fuzzy, though. Yeah, lots of warm fuzzies, but you wouldn't meet your guide or have a light review or a lot of the other elements. You wouldn't spend time in the light, for example.
Okay.
Yeah. A good book for OBEs is Robert Monroe. He's written a few books on that. He's probably the most well-known person. And also, NDERF also has an OBE section. So if you want to read other OBEs.
Okay, and what was his name again, please?
Robert Monroe.
Monroe, okay.
Yes, Monroe.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah, it's good.
I'm trying to take notes here.
Well, I'm glad. I'm glad that you're finding it interesting enough that you want to take notes. That's great.
Yeah.
Well, of course we do. Now, I'm sure you get asked this a lot, and I don't mean to be cliche, but I know that some of the listeners are going to berate me for not asking.
Okay.
Does your faith determine who you see on the other side?
Oh, that's a wonderful question. Yes, it definitely does, because we will, for example, somebody who is raised a Christian will probably see Jesus. Very often they see Jesus. A person who is raised Muslim would see Muhammad. And somebody who is raised Jewish might see Moses or Abraham or somebody like that. So the point is that you will see something that relates to the faith that you are. Yes. And that happens common. That's very common.
So does that mean that all of those people are on the other side waiting for us and they get selected according to your faith? Or is that how does that work?
Okay. I'll try to explain. We are spirit. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
We are not body. We are only in a body. Spirit is in a body experiencing life. Okay? So, like I said before, your love energy. That's what your reality is. So you are spirit, and they are spirit. So you would see them because you are of the same element.
Okay. I got you.
So if you were over there and you decided you wanted to see, say, for example, you're a Christian, and you said, well, I want to see Muhammad, you would probably see Muhammad because that's what you want to see.
So what you're saying is it's one spirit, but we just see him in by different different faces.
Right.
Okay.
Exactly. It's all the same spirit. That's what oneness is. Mm-hmm. And that's what I try and teach with my workshop. I show how that works because people say to me, well, how can you be separated and one at the same time? And so the workshop teaches that.
Now, if somebody wanted to get a hold of your book or actually get to speak with you or make contact with you, how would they do that?
Okay. My book is on Amazon.com, and in Canada, it's also on Amazon, or they can go through Chapters online, because it's at the Canadian online place. And so and you can get a hold of me. The name of my book, The Wonder of You, What the Near-Death Experience Tells You About Yourself, I have a Facebook with that name. And then I have Lynn Russell with LinkedIn and Gmail, and I'm Google Plus. And Twitter, I'm ArtSoul2. Lots of names. But I'm also there under Lynn Russell. So Lynn K. Russell. And I use Kathleen because there are a bazillion Lynn Russells out there. I think every city's got 50. So I use Lynn Kathleen Russell to distinguish.
Oh, okay. Well, is there a... Now, I couldn't hear everything you said. Is there a website that we can go to get in touch with?
Yes, thank you. I didn't say the website. The website is LynnKathleenRussell.com.
Kathleen?
Lynn, L-I-N-N. So, Kathleen Russell, R-U-S-S-E-L-L.
Okay.
.com. And then, or just even Google me. I'm on Google, and also you can even Google my book, either me or my book, and it'll all come up.
Okay.
Yes, and
are you on Facebook also?
I'm sorry?
Facebook also?
Yes, I'm on Facebook under the name of my book.
Okay.
And I'm on LinkedIn under Lynn Russell, and I'm under Google Plus under Lynn Russell.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
And also, I've also posted your photo and a photo of your book and some of your information on our social media as well.
Wonderful. Thank you for doing that. That's great.
Well, it's our pleasure. So if you had any final words for our listeners here in this last couple of minutes that we have with you, what would you tell them?
First of all, thank you very much for tuning in and listening. I'm very pleased to have been able to talk with them. The other thing is to know that they are beautiful and to trust themselves. I think that's it.
Oh. And that is something that we actually take for granted. You know, we are beautiful.
Yes, very much so.
And saying that doesn't necessarily make you, arrogant or prideful or full of yourself.
No.
You have to see yourself the way God sees you to have actually constructed this entire process that you just described for us to surround us with love.
That's right.
But
this is your doing.
but
the bottom line is you're spirit in a body. Rumi says, we are not a drop in the ocean. We are the ocean in a drop.
Exactly.
That's our reality.
And that's so esoteric. Well, we have run out of time, Lynn. I thank you. You are such a beautiful soul, and I'm honored to have had you on this show, and you've really, really enlightened us. And in the chat room, we were discussing some pretty deep things that you were bringing up.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Well, thank your audience for me.
Well, they're listening now.
Thanks for having me. I really appreciate this.
Thank you for taking your time, you know, out of your busy time. I know you're probably quite busy, so you know, we thank you for joining us.
I appreciate it. That's fine. Okay, so look after yourself.
Okay, and we will hopefully see you in May.
Okay, hopefully.
I'm keeping my fingers crossed too.
Okay. All right.
Thank you
again.
Thank you very much, Lynn. Good night.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Well, Molly, what did we say?
We did another good one.
Oh,
another fascinating one.
We did. I'm actually going to go to like a minute commercial and take care of something real quick, and then we'll come back and close out the show.
Alrighty. Well, sit tight.
Everybody just...
Hope everybody else will too.
Just stick with us. We'll be right back.
Dear John, I was hoping it wouldn't come to this, but you've left me no choice. I'm leaving. Uncontrolled high blood pressure is really serious, and lately you seem to really not care. I've been there for you since day one, and I know you think I'm going to keep ticking. But no, my friend, I can quit whenever I want. Why can't we get back to the good times, when we were more active and ate more healthy foods, and you checked on me every once in a while? Is that too much to ask? I don't want to leave, but unless you stop ignoring me, what else am I supposed to do? Remember, when I quit, you quit. Sincerely, your heart.
Listen to your heart. Don't let it quit on you. Doing the minimum to control your high blood pressure isn't doing enough. High blood pressure can lead to a stroke, heart attack, or death. Get your blood pressure to a healthy range before it's too late. Find out how at heart.org/bloodpressure. Check, change, control. A message from the American Heart Association, the American Stroke Association, and the Ad Council.
Okay.
Well, everybody, we are back. I just had to take a real quick break so that I didn't sneeze into the microphone. But,
spread germs everywhere.
Yes. We can't get the listeners sick. So,
exactly.
And Joyce said, great show. She managed to stay awake. Well, what is that saying, Joyce? Do we normally put you to sleep?
No, she gets up quite early, and so she goes to bed early.
So, oh, and Britta
is saying
good night.
I'm glad she stuck with us tonight. She took a nap.
And good girl, she finally got to listen to a live broadcast.
Yeah. So, glad you could join us.
But, man, that was a good show. I mean, it was a very sobering show.
It was.
And brought out a lot of discussion, and everybody made some very, very good points in the chat room. Mm-hmm. I'm kind of stuck on a discussion that we were having in the chat room, and it's more than coincidence that Lynn, you know, wanted to discuss suicide. How do you feel about assisted suicide in suffering?
You know, well, that's what I wonder too, and we probably should ask Lynn. You know, and if you do assist in that, does that come back on you too? You know, I don't know.
Yeah, because I got mixed feelings. You know, like
we put our animals down when we don't want them to suffer any longer, but we don't do that as human beings very often. And then when we do, are we punished for helping and assisting?
You are absolutely right. I mean, animals are loving, living creatures, you know, creatures of mm-hmm. God, and we're not above putting them down.
Mm-hmm. So I don't know. We should have asked that while we had her, I guess.
Boy. Yeah, isn't that the way it goes? As soon as the guest checks out, you're like, I should have said this or should have said that. I do that on the tours. You know, I'll tell the historical story, I'll tell the haunting story, and then I'll be like, oh, doggone it, I should have included this detail.
Yeah. Well, if I see her in May, I'll ask her. We'll just have to wait, you know, like Paul Harvey for the rest of the story.
Oh, now we're dating ourselves.
Yeah.
We're
dating ourselves. Well, I think most people listen to the show or know who Paul Harvey is. He hasn't been gone that long.
No, you know, and I quote him in the tours because I always tell people, and now you know, and they all finish it.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, his son took that over. Paul Harvey's son, after he passed. Yes.
Yeah.
You know, but it's not
the same. I haven't heard anything about him, though. I mean, I've not heard him on radio or TV or anything. Where do you get his stories?
I don't remember the station. We were traveling, and I believe I was driving through Mississippi on my way to Huntsville, Texas, and I was flipping channels because I got bored with some shows I was listening to, and there he was, and I was like, well, this guy mm-hmm. sounds like he's trying to imitate Paul Harvey, and it was his son.
Oh.
But it just wasn't the same. Mm-hmm. It wasn't the same. I was lamenting with one of our tour guests this very weekend, and he was like, "Ah, I remember Paul Harvey," and we were just kind of missing him. Oh, Bob says he has the son's book.
Oh, okay.
So. But goodness.
Yeah. Well, Joyce said she has assisted helping several cross over. What we're talking about is more of a medical type assistance. Isn't that what you were?
Yes.
Having in mind? Yeah.
Yeah. Kind of like the, let's just say it. You know, Dr. Kevorkian.
Yeah. That's what I thought you were referring to.
Mm hmm. I absolutely was.
And, you know, I think that's different than making the decision to pull the plug or whatever when you're given that choice to help somebody cross over. I don't think that's really the same thing. If everything else has been done and you pull the plug and leave everything turned over to God, everything from there on out, then that's God's choice if they should heal and come back to us or to go ahead and go with him. So I don't think that's the same thing.
Yeah, ending the suffering.
Yeah, because you're really not making the final death choice. You're not putting an end to that. That's still God's choice.
Yeah. You know, just now I just got a message from our good friend Al, and he said that up in Canada that assisted suicide is legal. Mm-hmm. And the
I had heard that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The social cultural view is that it's okay. So mm-hmm. what is our issue with it here?
I'm not what I'm saying, I'm not asking if it's okay with everyone in general. How does God view that?
Yeah,
the people here is not what I'm concerned about, how they view it or not view it or whatever, but how does it end up in the end when we do face God over it?
Mm. Yeah.
How is it accepted through him?
Because you're helping end a life that he created, and maybe he had more purpose for it.
You know, exactly. And, you know, would that be viewed as murder in his eyes? Or, you know, I don't know. I've got so many questions on that.
We just need a 3-hour show.
Another hour show.
We need to go back to
back
the 3-hour format.
Get back on here. We still got questions.
Oh, goodness. Well, gang, I do need to announce one thing. Our good friend Al Warren, he is actually traveling. So
he's in Hollywood, isn't he?
Yes, he is. Living the
Mr.
life.
Mr. Fancy Pants.
Yeah. Oh, look at me. I'm in Hollywood.
I know.
But he will not be doing his normal live show, or, well, his show tonight. Yeah, so we're just rolling the dice. We're going to leave it up to the server to find something. But just in case, you know, I know that very many of you like to stay afterwards and listen to his show, but he is actually traveling. So, there it is.
Yeah.
And don't forget to bring me something, Al. I know you're listening.
I want something, too. Me too.
He's probably posing with Elvis impersonators.
But, well, I saw that he was on the Hollywood Walk of Fame earlier today. So, wonder if he's getting a handprint and be able to write his name in a little slab of cement there.
But uh-oh.
Uh-oh, what? What uh-oh. Happened? No, uh-oh. Not Hollywood, Alabama. Hollywood, California. Uh-oh, there's that menacing bartender or yeah. whoever he is, the bouncer.
That jerk.
Yeah. We have to deal with him every week. Can we not fire him, get somebody else?
You know, somebody that'll leave us alone and let us do it the way we want, how we want, and as long as we want.
We do. We still got dancing to do.
And here it goes. Britta's favorite part of the show.
Get your dancing shoes on. We're going to polka.
Well, everybody, you have been listening to The Buzz on ztalkradio.com. We'll be with you again next Monday night. Same place, same time. And keep your eye out. I'm going to be posting it as soon as we get everything scheduled and set up for our new show on ztalkradio.com. The Rod Eccles Show.
That'll be cool.
Yeah, I'm excited. I mean, we're doing new and fresh and exciting stuff here at Z-Talk Radio.
We're going beyond where man's never gone before.
Yes, I am excited because we're doing new stuff here. On Z-Talk. We're taking Z-Talk further than it's ever been taken before.
Well, that's where we get imagine the possibilities.
Yes. And yeah. Scotty's proud and excited, so there it is.
Yeah. But nobody's hearing the roll up the barrel.
Well, let me cut it up. Because we can actually let it roll a little while tonight.
Yeah, we're talking over all the music.
Oh.
Are we all have a